was the fact that enough money was available to bid for infrastructure projects. And because bank finance was available to anyone and everyone, we had a large number of people doing infrastructure construction work. And that effectively led to competition. Competition led to aggressive pricing to an extent that this pricing did not factor in any potential contingencies that came about. Another factor that did impact our industry was that because money was available and because internationally assets were available cheap, given that a lot of assets had lost value, Indian promoters thought that this was possibly the best time to diversify. So we had a lot of diversification, be it in automobiles, in construction, in cement, in seeds, in sugar. And all these industries went ahead and diversified, buying global assets, which they hoped they could turn around. Even on the financing side, frankly, money was available fairly cheap overseas, given that interest rates, the soft interest rate policies were adopted by most countries. And because money was available cheap, Indians effectively entered into carry trade transactions, be it with the US dollar or with the yen. And we built up significant positions around external commercial borrowings, around foreign currency guaranteed loans, export related loans. And though it was perceived that interest rate was lower in the international currency regime, what we did not factor in is we hoped that the rupee would remain stable. And if the rupee were to slide, the cost, the carry trade would actually vanish. So these were the situations in which we started. The other thing is, because one bank was growing as 26%, every other bank in India also had to grow at 26%. And what really happened is that every bank was vying to give credit to any and every person who applied for it. So we have a situation, accumulation of all of this, is that there was excess liquidity available to the corporates. The corporates banked with multiple bankers, and that excess liquidity led them to either bid aggressively for contracts or buy assets at prices or liabilities that they could not sustain. While this all happened in 2006-2007, this carried on for a number of years, and right up to around 2010-2011, this problem carried on. What we realized in 2010, for example, is that the world economy was not going to recover very quickly as was expected then. And the India carry trade, which is the difference between India and the global economy, started to shrink. We also had a period of political indecisiveness and a fair amount of scams that happened, be it telecom, be it coal. Accumulative factors of all these, especially in the UPA 2 term, led us to a situation where banks were willing to lend money just to pay interest. And between, say, 2010-11 and 2013-14, this trend continued. At the end of it, we had approximately 4 or 5 years of interest being accumulated on debt, which made companies unviable. The projects were anyway not meeting targets, hence those projects were unviable. Contingencies were not built into construction contracts, hence they went off. So accumulative of this really resulted in the bad debt situation in India growing large. Come 2015, the Central Bank of India effectively declared that they were going to discontinue a scheme called the CDR, or the Comprehensive Debt Restructuring Scheme, where all banks participated together, which basically kicked the can on bad debt recognition over from 2010-11 onwards. And the RBI said that we will now try and record some of these, and the provisioning dispensations that were available would now go away. That led to banks declaring a lot of the NPAs. So effectively, the banks started doing their own self-disclosures. The Reserve Bank of India conducted something called an asset quality review. An accumulation of those resulted in an estimated $100 to $150 billion worth of bad debt in the Indian system today. And frankly, that's quite an alarming number that came about in March 2015. And the Reserve Bank was then compelled to come out with a scheme. This was just to give you an overview of how big the market is. Now, around 1992, another flashback, The government came up with a rule called the Sarfaesi Act, which was basically an act which allowed a specific acquisition of assets. And this, sorry, not 1992, 2002, my apologies. So basically, this act allowed companies to repossess specific assets and turn around. As part of this act, they also introduced something called an asset reconstruction company. And an asset reconstruction company was effectively a vehicle which could acquire an asset, pay part of the consideration of that asset to the bank, and for the balance issue the banks a certificate or a paper of entitlement. But the expectation was that these asset reconstruction companies would build the expertise to recover assets better than the banks could do. Initially, we had a few asset reconstruction companies, the biggest one being Asset Reconstruction Company of India, ARCIL. And thereafter, as the law opened up over a period of time between 2002 and now, many more came in the picture. Today, we have around 23 asset reconstruction companies in the country. Together, they have approximately $6 billion in terms of AUM in the last that they have accumulated over a period of time. Many more have applied, and the business models of asset reconstruction companies have changed over the years. I will request Rahul to take that up. But frankly, what I wanted to end at to say is that we have a $150 billion problem on the debt restructuring side, which is fairly large. And over this period of time, as the Reserve Bank has come out with respective schemes, what's also happened is the intermediation, as in the advisors on distressed assets, over a period of time have also metamorphosized quite significantly. People like E&Y and its competitors have come in much more in the market. Much more credible intermediation is now happening in this market. And we hope that that would lead to better resolution strategies as well as better asset pricing as we go forward. I hand over to Rahul, who is a director colleague of mine. And Rahul, his credential is that he has worked with Phoenix ARCs, one of the successful ARC companies owned by Kotak Mahindra Bank, a very successful turnaround bank in India. And I will leave it to him to explain and take you through the modalities of an ERC.
Yeah, many thanks, Abizer. Welcome all. I think carrying off from where Abizer left, in terms of the act which came in back in 2002, which kind of enabled the formation of these specialized vehicles to address the bad loan problem. So the evolution of ARCs is very interesting. In fact, I've been fortunate enough to be part of this cycle from back in 2005-2006. Initially, what used to happen is these vehicles were primarily seen in terms of a takeover of the bad loan from various banks and institutions for payment of a minimum percentage of cash. In fact, when it started back in 2002, there were about two ARCs which got registered at that point in time, ARCIL and Pegasus. Initially, there was a requirement of not paying any cash, so the loan could be transferred. And basically, these ARCs were empaneled to kind of work on a resolution model basis. And there used to be a defined mechanism based on which the distribution used to happen. So from there on, I think there has been a massive change wherein the RBI had increased the minimum requirement in terms of a commitment in a transaction where an ARC takes over the bad loan from a bank to 5%. So this came back in 2006-2007. So I think one important reason that we need to understand in terms of the evolution also boils down from the fact that primarily, the legal recoveries that were available to the lenders were either through a debt recovery tribunal, wherein banks used to file suits in courts, which used to take years together in terms of a resolution. Then there were Lok Adalats, which were spread across the country, which acted more like the small causes courts, where again the timeline in terms of deciding on any case used to take a very long period of time. So when the Sarfaesi got enacted and when the specialized vehicles started getting set up, I think initially there was a fair bit of success in terms of recovery of assets. As we moved along in terms of, you can see on the screen in terms of the evolution that I just explained from where we were back in 1993 when the Nurseman Committee had kind of recommended to where we are today in terms of continuous amendments happening by the regulator, and we have almost 23 asset reconstructions company in India. Primarily, in terms of the regulation, the ARCs are guided by the Surface Act. We've tried to just summarize in terms of the registration requirements of setting up an ARC. The governing laws is the Securitization and Reconstruction of the Financial Assets and Enforcement of Security Interest Act, which was set up way back in 2002. The vehicles which have to be registered under this act may need to make an application with the RBI extending their interest in kind of setting up this activity. Based on certain primary checks in terms of the sponsor entities and in terms of minimum capital requirement, which at this point in time stands at 2 crores Indian rupees, the RBI grants licenses to such specialized vehicles to operate as asset reconstruction company. At the time of filing for an application, basically there is a requirement of filing a 3-year business plan in terms of the acquisition strategy as well as a resolution plan, the audited statement of owned funds where the money is going to come from, and a detailed information in terms of the sponsor entities. So these requirements have been there over the last 14 years, so not much of a change have we seen in these requirements. But I think with increasing entities wanting to set up ARCs in India, I think a lot of these regulations are being revisited from our information from the regulator, is that some of these requirements, including increasing the minimum capital requirement for an ARC, that is likely to undergo a change. So I think there's going to be interesting times. The more recent one is in terms of the annual budget 2016, which came up with a host of changes that included giving a tax relief to the special purpose vehicles set up by the ARCs, as well as the holding in the ARCs, which earlier used to be a 49% stake through the automatic route, and beyond that used to go through a specific approval. Now they have relaxed that, and they have allowed for 100% FDI in the asset reconstruction company. So we view it as a very positive change. And as a matter of fact, I think there have been a lot of inquiries, and this has kind of created a buzz in the Indian system, especially from the overseas investors, where at least we as EY have been seeing quite a bit of traction in terms of inquiries and people wanting to set up and explore the space in terms of partnering the existing ARCs or probably taking up new licenses. Going on, I think in terms of the existing structure that we have, I think it's a fairly simple structure. Typically, the capital structure engages debt or through a preference share structure in terms of the equity base. As far as the owned fund is concerned, as the ARC starts building up their books in terms of acquisitions, it is a requirement for them to maintain 100 crore net worth or 15% of the assets owned, whichever is lesser. So once the minimum threshold is reached, and today the top ARCs that are there which have sizable assets in their books are more or less at 100 plus of net worth in their books. From a capital adequacy perspective, I think it's very clear that an ARC needs to have 15% capital adequacy, and the security receipts, the mode of instrument that the ARCs deal with primarily is assigned a risk weightage of 100%. Coming to the sources of income for the ARC, I think what used to evolve as a management trusteeship fee under the earlier structure has gradually moved to a resolution incentive structure, wherein more and more transactions the banks are doing with ARCs, they are incentivizing the ARCs for doing higher recoveries. So there is a percentage of recoveries that get paid out as a recovery incentive fee over and above the management trusteeship fee that the ARC earns from managing the trust. The ARC's business model, as we speak, is fairly straightforward in terms of the structure. The non-performing loan gets sold out by the bank to the ARC under a trust structure. The trust holds the asset against which the ARC issues what is called as a security receipt, which is basically a paper which is redeemed at the time of recoveries made into this account over a period of time. At this point in time, as we speak, the minimum regulatory minimum prescribed limits is 15% cash down by the ARCs, and balance 85% being held by the seller bank or any other investor. We will be seeing a change as we move ahead with the recent changes in the guidelines in September 2016, which came about, which I'll be taking up a little later as we move along. In terms of the resolution, I think there are two elements which are there primarily in terms of the resolution incentive fee that I spoke about, which gets paid out to the ARC as a fee income. And there is a very clear-cut waterfall mechanism that is defined in terms of how the money gets distributed in terms of any recoveries into the trust. The advantage of having a trust account is very simple. It is treated as a pass-through instrument, and it serves from a tax perspective also in terms of giving a tax break in terms of distribution of monies. So from a distribution perspective, in terms of the waterfall mechanism, largely the waterfall mechanism follows the following steps. Any recovery that happens, the first monies go towards adjusting the resolution expenses which are incurred by the ARCs. The next goes towards payment of the management trusteeship fee to the ARC for managing the trust and the transaction. The monies left, which is basically the net recoveries, go towards redemption of the security receipts which are held primarily in the ratio of 15:85 by the ARC and the selling bank. We have seen some transactions in the market where there is a coupon payment which typically is in the range of anywhere between 8 to 10%, which gets paid out as a next. And beyond this, whatever remains, there is typically an incentive fee for the ARC to maximize recovery. We have seen anywhere from 15.85 to 25.75 in favor of the ARC when it comes to the incentive structure. I think it's going to be interesting to see how the market has evolved from a number perspective also in terms of the transactions. What we have managed to kind of call out based on our primary research as well as from some of the news articles as well as the CRASIL reports. It's very evident in terms of the flow of transactions where under the 595 regime, there used to be a nominal acquisition by the ARCs, because at that point in time we had about 6 to 7 ARCs which were there in the market. So what started off when the economic recession happened, like Abizer explained, where frankly there was a lot of credit which was happening in the Indian market, the banks were not recognizing much of the NPAs in the system. So the initial phase was when the banks were still in a denial mode where not much of transactions were happening in the ARCs. As we moved along, when we thought that we were decoupled from the economic trends, when some of the investments that the borrowers had made did not yield the desired results, that's when the signs of stress started getting observed in the Indian market. And this is the time when the CDR, the most popular mechanism under which the restructuring used to happen, so that point in time during 2012-2013, the ARCs were still not doing much of acquisitions. So you can very clearly see from the numbers there. And come 2014, when the CDR system was failing in terms of restructuring, there was a spurt in acquisitions in terms of a massive selling by the banks to the ARCs. So you can notice from in 2014 and especially 2015, till about the time when the regime changed before the 1585 scheme came into play, there was a lot of acquisitions which happened, and I think the top 3-4 ARCs made quite a headway in terms of acquiring some of these NPAs in the market. A lot of these NPAs which got sold in the market were fresh NPAs. So to that extent, the lower bottom side of the table of the graph, if you see, the percentage of value that was issued against the acquisition as an acquisition price from what used to be 12-15% started increasing to 28% in FY13 to about 53%. So that really talks about the vintage of assets that kind of got sold to the ARCs. The newer NPAs had lesser provision in the books of the bank. So the ability of banks to take a higher haircut was not existing. Hence, these assets were priced closer to the book value because the ARCs used to play primarily on the trusteeship fee that they used to recover from the transaction, which used to cover up their investment of 5%. An example has been given in the side table wherein in a typical transaction of we've analyzed the three major trends that happened in the ARC market up to September 2006 when the ARCs did not have much of skin in the game. There was no investment consideration. And from then on, between the period of 2006 to 2014, where there was a minimum requirement of putting in 5% of the consideration. And from then on, when the regulator changed from 5% to 15%, I think there is a very clear change in terms of the returns for the ARCs, right from a 20-25% return, which used to be primarily coming out of the management fees that the ARC used to make, to about 8-10% IRR in a 15-85 scenario. So I think this has eventually discouraged some of the ARCs in the market to kind of bid at high levels. So we have seen at least in the market more serious transactions in terms of the pricing, and frankly, with an increase in regular requirement from 5-15%, we have seen ARCs having capital participating in a lot of these auctions that are done by the banks. So very clearly, the numbers also state that about 300 billion rupees of bad loans were sold before the regulation changed in 2014. As compared to that, it significantly dropped down to 100 billion rupees, where select transactions happened with a couple of ARCs working on a bilateral basis with the banks. We as EY feel, I think, this is a good scenario to be in because, frankly, the market has moved from where it was in terms of largely acquiring just based on the trusteeship fee to a market where in the long run, it is going to be price discovery in terms of serious players in the market who have capital. So the next screen where we are today, I think based on our preliminary research, we have just tried to put together some numbers just to get a give a flavor in terms of the market last year. There were roughly about 3,000 accounts which came into the market, which were kind of put for auction for the ARCs. The value, the outstanding principal balance of these loans were about close to $19 billion. That's a sizable number. If you see the bottom line, I think it's a pretty sad state of affairs that the estimated deal closures against this was about roughly 15%, which is about $2.8 billion. So you can see that the market moving from 5 to 15% has dissuaded some of the smaller ARCs, which are very small capital base, to kind of completely be out of the market. This has left primarily the top 4 or 5 ARCs, which have participated in these auctions, and the closure rate, which is basically 15% of the outstanding balance. The SRs issued against their against these loans were roughly 50% of the outstanding, which is about $1.4 billion. Interestingly, I think one of the household names, which I think all of us have been reading in the media in the enough in the papers, Edelweiss ARC, which has acquired a substantial portion of these assets with roughly a 50% market share. So I think this broadly talks about and summarizes in terms of the activity levels of the top 5 ARCs over the past few years. Very clearly, the in terms of the assets under management, Edelweiss has kind of overtaken some of the competitors by doing quite a bit of serious acquisitions over the last 2-3 years. We have Arcel, which is kind of having one of the oldest ARC, having a book of about 11,000 crores, followed by JM, Phoenix, and IARC. And the net worth of the ARCs are pretty much, I mean, apart from Arcel, which has kind of leveraged its balance sheet, we have more or less the other players in the 150 to 300 crore range. What we have also tried to do is, I mean, incidentally, I'm kind of connected to a lot of funds which kind of approach us from overseas in terms of the space, because with the introduction of the insolvency code, there a lot of people are interested in terms of setting up shops in India to kind of play a massive role in this space, because in the long run, they see deals happening. While at this point in time, probably there is a challenge in pricing, but with a long-term play in mind, there have been quite a bit of traction in this market. Initially, SSG Capital, one of the large distressed asset platforms in Asia-Pacific, acquired a strategic stake in the Delhi-based asset care enterprise. There have been quite a bit of applications which were filed in with RBI. In the last 4 months, we have seen at least about 6 applications coming through. We mentioned some names there, Encore, CFM, Prudent, etc. The recent news about 4-5 days back, there's the JV between JC Flowers, the American fund, with Ambit Capital, which has kind of received its license. So I think we are seeing quite a bit of traction in this market. So what was about 16 ARCs during the start of the year, we are already 23. And with at least about 8 to 10 more applications lying with RBI, we are seeing quite a bit of activity in the market. Apart from this, I think the strategy of banks have also moved from what used to be a single stake acquisition. Increasingly, we are seeing lenders to a transaction kind of joining hands with a lead bank and getting together and trying to sell an entire stake of the consortium to the ARC. This is, I think, we view this as a very positive move because, frankly, by just buying a 3-5% debt stake in a company is not going to really give any resolution control. We have seen the trend changing with Leela Ventures, which happened a little dated 2014, and the more recent transaction, which was Arts Pharma, where a consortium of lenders got together and kind of sold their entire exposure to one of the ARCs to give a better resolution control. So we believe going forward, I think that is going to be the strategy that will evolve to get a better recovery out of the stressed loan. The key challenges that we see in the market, I think pretty much clear in terms of the multiple lending situations and majority of the situations where there are inter-creditor conflicts where you have some of these smaller percentage creditors acting as holdout creditors, not really cooperating to any kind of a decision which is taken by the other major creditors. This has consequently led to a debt aggregation by the ARCs because typically the ARC vehicles, unless and until they get a sizable number in terms of the debt control, they are not really able to kind of chart out a resolution plan to kind of take control of the company as well as the assets of the company. So we have seen instances where it has taken a couple of years to complete the debt aggregation to kind of take complete control of the loan. I think a popular view that all the ARCs have always shared is in a mismatch in price expectations. This is something which we've always seen because typically the source of funds that an ARC raise is not the cheapest of funds. So obviously the return expectations for an ARC from a discounting factor perspective is above 20%. And compared to this, typically a bank, which a public sector bank, which has its cost of funds much lesser, there is a massive gap in terms of the return expectations of the ARC vis-a-vis lenders, which has primarily resulted in not many deals getting consummated in the market. So there has been a lack of clarity in terms of acquisition of SMA2 accounts because SMA2 accounts, the definition as it stands, are accounts where the outstanding is more than 60 days, but it is less than 90 days. So it is not an NPA account. While the charter of an ARC allows them to buy both NPA accounts as well as SMA2 accounts, there's no clear guidance in terms of whether a SARFAESI will apply on an SMA2 account. Because of the issues surrounding the enforceability of assets of an SMA2 account, ARCs have largely stayed away from kind of acquiring these assets from that perspective. However, we're seeing some changes happening on that count. I think ARCs are now taking a call that they will work very closely with the stakeholders in acquisition of these SMA2 accounts and work out a resolution plan. Applicability of SDR guidelines, I think it's pretty much clear that while ARCs are part of the SDR guidelines, the ARC charter does not allow them to kind of hold more than 26% equity in any company. So unless an ARC is given a complete majority control, we see that it's going to be difficult for them to kind of implement a resolution mechanism. From an accounting implication, I think while there was a lot of issues surrounding the concept of true sale, because from a 1585 perspective, it is largely seen that the risk and the reward continues to be with the seller bank, because the 85% of the loan still continues to be in the books of the bank. I think RBI has viewed this seriously, and they have come with a host of regulations very recently in September 2016. I'll be discussing in a subsequent slide. I think from a secondary market perspective, we have not seen much of transactions in terms of trading of SRs, which typically happen in some of the markets, some of the developed markets overseas, when it comes to the Asia Pacific or the UK market, where some of these instruments are traded. So we hope in the shortly in India as well, there will be a situation where some of these SRs get traded. So the regulatory impact, which I've been dealing with earlier, I think there has been a pretty good evolution in terms of where we were earlier, where a majority of these accounts get used to get restructured under a CDR forum. The accounts then moved from a CDR forum because the regulator came down very heavily in terms of imposing higher provisioning requirements, with a view to bring about more skin in the game of the promoter and kind of ensure that the banks take control. The SDR, popularly called, which is basically the strategic debt restructuring, was introduced by the RBI back in June 2015, which gave a tool to the lenders to kind of take management control and kind of turn around companies by offloading it to a strategic or a financial investor. And the more recent development in terms of the bankruptcy code, which has kind of created a buzz in the economy and kind of evinced interest from a lot of overseas investors, I think it was pretty much required, because I think the one number which kind of is interesting to all of us in terms of the kind of resolution time frame it takes in India to kind of recover any kind of money is significantly high when you compare with some of our Western countries. It takes on an average anywhere close to 4.5 to 5 years to recover, and the recovery is about 25 to 26 cents to a dollar. And you compare that with some of the other countries where the recovery is as high as 72 to 75 cents a dollar, and it happens much faster. I think the whole intention of the bankruptcy law is to kind of consolidate the multiple laws that we have in India into one single legislation, and we see it as a very positive move that the government has taken in terms of passing the law. So it's going to be interesting a few months from now on in terms of how this entire thing evolves. Specific to the ARCs, where there have been budget regulations which have come in, which have kind of relaxed the investments into ARCs, where the sponsor entity could hold the entire 100%. And this could happen either through a domestic fund or an overseas fund. There has been a tax clarity which has been brought about in terms of the income that an ARC earns. Now is very clear that it will be taxed in the hands of the investor. So the trust is viewed as a pass-through instrument with no tax implications. So these are some of the changes that were brought about by the budget specifically for the ARCs. And the September 16 guidelines that I just spoke about a few slides earlier, which have made things interesting going forward, and which probably have ensured that the few ARCs which have capital will survive. I think the intention of the circular is extremely clear, with a view to ensure that there is more skin in the game of the ARC, and the transactions which take place between the ARC and the banks are not seen as back-to-back in terms of the risk and reward still continuing to retain with the bank. The RBI has come with a strong circular which goes as follows, that any sale that happens, if the consideration received by way of a cash to SR proportion is less than 50-50, the banks will have to treat the sale as though the sale never happened, and the provisioning will have to happen as though the asset continued in the books of the bank. So which in effect has kind of dissuaded a bank to do any transaction on a 15-85 basis. The reason is very simple. A 50-50 structure will put more skin in the game of the ARC, because to that extent the cash is higher. So it is incentivizing the ARC to kind of use all their resources to kind of recover from these assets. Just to give a sense to the audience here in terms of the recovery rate of ARC from primary research as well as our discussions with a lot of the ARCs in the market. There is very strong view that the recovery percentage is anywhere between 25 to 28%. So this has been viewed very negatively amongst the banking system, and primarily has been one of the reasons why a lot of sales have not happened to the ARCs. I think when better skin is in the game by putting in more percentage of the upfront consideration, it is naturally expected that the recovery rates also improve in the long run, and ARCs are incentivized to recover them a higher figure over a lesser time. In fact, this regulation will kick in from the financial year starting 2017-2018. And as we move along from 2018-2019, the proportion 50-50 will then move to 10-90. So it's going to make, it's probably made things very, very interesting. And it's kind of, so in our view, what will be left is some of the high vintage assets, wherein there is adequate provisioning of the lenders of about 40% to 100%. Are the assets which typically will end up getting sold to ARCs on a 15-85 basis. On a 50-50 basis, frankly, from a pricing perspective, I think it will effectively boil down to a cash pricing, because the return expectations of an ARC are typically upwards of 20%. So we will eventually see a market which will boil down to a cash market, wherein there will be a pricing discovery which will happen. And the ARC which has bid for the highest value from a cash perspective will be eventually the ARC that will kind of work towards resolution of the asset. Apart from this, from bringing in a transparency perspective, there have been certain regulation changes which have come in, wherein all the banks are now expected to form a policy in terms of sale of assets to the ARCs. So at the start of the year, they are expected to finalize the policy and kind of get it ratified by the board. There is a more formal mechanism in terms of putting out these assets for sale with ARCs, which will now happen more periodically going forward. And a reserve price will be fixed and it will be disclosed to the participating investors. And the ARC which has met the reserve price is expected to kind of take the asset in the auction. So I think the intention of the RBI is to move to a platform where only the serious bidders remain. And precisely the reason why, which has attracted the interest from a lot of top global funds, I think with the recent introduction of the JV between JC Flowers and Ambit, I think we're going to be seeing serious transactions happening in the market on a cash basis. And typically the ARCs which will kind of remain will be the ones which would have kind of built out their complete setup right from the operational capabilities. Putting in additional funds into some of these companies to kind of revive such companies, because eventually whatever gets priced out as an acquisition price has a direct impact on the kind of recovery that the ARC will make and eventually on the returns of these specialized vehicles. So we are seeing interesting times. I think we see a very clear opportunity in this space in terms of the market potential, like Abizer started by mentioning that the market estimate of the NPAs and the restructured loans are estimated to be close to about $150 to $165 billion. That's about 11 to 12% of the gross advances. The size of the ARCs that we have in market today, frankly, the capital of those ARCs can roughly address about 3% of the banking industry problem. This leaves room for quite a sizable opportunity for the ARCs to kind of ramp up capital. And set up distress funds where they kind of invite overseas participation put in additional money into these companies to kind of revive such stressed loans. So with that, I think we are open to questions. I have Abizer also with me, so we're happy to take any questions. I think Imarticus, you want to just kind of brief how you want to take the Q&A session?
Yeah, sure. So we have a couple of questions. Are you visible? Is it visible to you, or do you want me to read it out?
We are unable to see the questions here, actually.
Okay. So Sandeep Narang, he asks Rahul, can an ARC acquire a company which is distressed, or is it that an ARC can only acquire assets under a stress?
So basically, so the ARC's charter today has allowed them to buy both the SMA2 accounts, which is basically overdue for more than 60 days, as well as non-performing loans, which are basically classified where the interest or the principal or the installment lies unpaid for more than 90 days. While the charter allows acquisition of both sets of accounts, what we have seen in the market is ARCs have largely acquired NPA loans. Having said that, there are ARCs which have acquired SMA2 accounts also. I think what we need to understand, the underlying issue in an SMA2 transaction is the SARFAESI Act, which basically is the father act, which kind of overrules, is that the enforcement, the initiation of a SARFAESI and the enforcement of security interests kicks in when an account is an NPA, declared as a non-performing asset. So there is no reference in terms of what if the loan is not non-performing. So there have been, from our side, what we can only share is we've had discussions with the regulator, we've had discussions with the ARCs, is that there is nothing which stops the ARC from acquiring a SMA2 loan account, except that the provisioning norms will apply as though the ARC is buying in its own books. So SMA2 accounts today, whatever transactions have happened in the market, have been acquisitions which have happened in an ARC's own balance sheet and not through these special trusts that are set up. Yeah, and from an acquisition of a company perspective, I mean, this is from an acquisition of the debt in the company, and from acquisition of the company itself, once they have acquired the debt, the charter is very clear that an ARC cannot buy equity more than 26% in a company. So that's a maximum that they can hold in any stressed loan.
Okay, so the next question is from Harshan. He wants to ask a question about the future of real estate and housing finance companies after the demonetization. Will there be a growth in the organized sector, or will it be a total negative on the whole industry?
So very unrelated question to the asset reconstruction world, but presumably that question has been asked because real estate is distressed. At the moment, frankly, as far as real estate is concerned, one is that there is a little bit of supply, especially on the land side. I think, as I explained earlier, because of the abundance of finance available, there was a fair amount of land bank that has been held by the real estate sector. So as far as land prices and land transactions are concerned, there would be a fair amount of illiquidity at the current levels of pricing. Coming to the real estate sector, in the real estate sector, frankly, there is still a lot of structured finance opportunity for near to complete projects. So for near to complete projects where the loan to values are attractive, which is loan to value means the amount of loan given to the value of the asset. And at 50 and 60% of those loan to asset values, there is enough structured finance available which covers interest and principal, because even if the real estate prices were to drop 25 to 30%, there is an ability to monetize and recover interest plus principal. So at the near to complete project value, there is a structured finance opportunity, which is good. Of course, the locational advantage of the land, etc., will be important. Now, coming to the actual real estate sector, because of a little bit of overtrading and illiquidity in the system, may face a bit of distress. Given the fact, one, that in the demonetized environment, the informal means of financing for the real estate sector would dry up in the short run, and that would create some kind of liquidity panic, and hence some forced sales, and those forced sales will actually drive down prices. I hope I've answered the question.
Okay, so another question we have from Abhishek Bakshi is, are ARC been treated as a collection agent in the current scenario in absence of holding more than 26% capital in the stressed company?
Well, frankly, I think two models that ARCs have worked on, primarily the investment model and the collection agency model. I think this has been pretty much the trend that we've been seeing in the market since the formation of the ARCs. I would say the top set of ARCs are extremely clear in their strategy. I think they want to go big in terms of the acquisitions and putting in money in terms of revival of some of these companies. And at least in the transactions that we have been seeing in the market in the recent past, we see them as people who will work closely with the stakeholders for revival. So I don't see them as just collection agents. And coming to the other set of guys who are there's a lack of capital. I think their model has more or less moved towards smaller acquisitions, or they're happy to kind of work with the existing lenders to recover money more on a commission agency basis. And there are arrangements, there are formal mechanisms to do this. So I would probably put it this way, that the serious players in the market will continue to see this as an investment game. So I hope that I've answered that question.
Okay, we have another question to Mr. Abizer from Rishwa. He asks, why do you think corporates who choose ECB didn't bother to hedge Forex exposure? Were they too naive to believe that Forex rates couldn't be more adverse?
Well, you know, in hindsight, yes, you can say that they were too naive. But if you look at it at that point in time, when the general sentiment was that the Indian economy will continue to grow at 8%, while the rest of the world languishes, there was a view formed that you know, foreign currencies will decline and rupee will remain stable, and hence there is an arbitrage between exchange rate and interest rate because of the excessive liquidity positioning that most economies did just for recovery. So earlier the estimation was that this is going to be 1 or 2 year problem. And frankly, if we infuse liquidity in the system, it will spur demand and demand will spur growth. But obviously that did not happen because the problem was too systemic. And even till today, frankly, we are struggling with that kind of growth. So I think people believe that this arbitrage will remain. But what really happened is that India corrected itself for a variety of reasons. One is, of course, that we had certain policy paralysis also and certain scams. And that obviously accelerated the process. And hence, you know, certain calculations went haywire. So at that point in time, the decision was, of course, optimistic and possibly correct. But as I said earlier, nobody had really factored in too many contingencies expecting India to continue to grow.
Okay, Ankit has a question. He is asking, how is the involvement of the existing promoter during the resolution process and the post-resolution?
Right. Of course, experience is varying. There are promoters who are extremely cooperative in the process, and most other promoters may not be. But frankly, what one has seen is that the promoter behavior has changed quite significantly. Earlier, frankly, they took the system for granted and just basically got incremental financing from banks to be able to repay interest and were hoping for the cycle to turn. And nobody ever thought of giving up control, especially with the Reserve Bank of India's circulars coming around a change in control and around sustainable debt, and the fact that banks have provided over a period of time has put a lot of promoters on the back foot. Also, from a macroeconomic point of view, the promoters realize that this is a long drawn out recovery, and hence they are more than cooperative to save their enterprise today. So as long as, in short, as long as what we have seen until now, where as long as the promoter sees that there is skin in the game for him in a revival process, he has generally been cooperative. Where an asset has been forcibly taken over from a promoter, there are enough and more issues that the promoter has been able to create, because generally the information gap between what the banker has and the promoter has is so wide that the promoter can actually play around with a lot of things. So hence, non-cooperation of the promoter drives down value, and that frankly ultimately impacts only the creditor or the banker, because the promoters don't have too much of an equity left in their businesses today. So in short, a promoter cooperation is improving because they all believe that it's a longer duration process for recovery.
Okay, Samir has a question to anyone. What is the role of a CA in asset reconstruction?
Yeah, I mean, chartered accountants can play a lot more roles. So for one, now under the new bankruptcy code, a chartered accountant is allowed to be an insolvency professional. And the role of an insolvency professional in a bankruptcy situation is to be able to take hold of the company, make sure the operations of the company are stabilized, prepare information that can be put out into public domain, so his understanding of the business, reducing the information gap between what the creditors have and what the company has, and ultimately inviting and evaluating various resolution plans that various stakeholders may put into the company. So that's a very big role and a big onus that has been put on chartered accountants, because they are one of the people who can register as IPs. However, it requires a very commercial bend of mind, not necessarily an accounting one. On the other side, frankly, there are a fair amount of accounting and tax issues to be dealt with, and the regulatory process is fairly strong, because we have to deal with SEBI-related issues, we have to deal with Company Act-related issues, and especially on the tax-related issues, especially for merger and demergers, because you may actually segregate a good business out of a bad business. But fundamentally, they need to have a business acumen to work towards a conservative revival policy.
Okay, Beena has a question. She asks, how do you see the future of ARC sector in next 3 to 5 years?
Right. See, basically ARCs have changed over a period of time. Initially, when we started, we had a 525 scheme where they only had to pay 5% of the money and 95% was given by way of security receipts, as Rahul explained. Now, in that, they got a 2% per annum fee on the value of the asset, and frankly, if they received fee for 3 years, they recovered all their investment back. And if that was the case, frankly, investment valuations did not matter. But then we changed to a 595 scheme to a 1585 scheme. In that, they had to contribute 15%, and their recoveries were based on actual amounts received from the company, and hence they could not recognize fees as easily. Fees were dependent on actual receipt of cash plus the mark-to-market on the security receipts. That placed a much more onus on the valuations being done by the credit rating agencies. So effectively, as the system matured, we are now at a stage where an asset reconstruction company is a good warehouser of all assets from banks, so that a collective decision can be taken in the interest of revival. So if ARCs have that bent of mind, those ARCs will succeed. Secondly, ARCs need to have a pool of capital, either available to them as a fund or they can be easily sourced for transactions, such that they are able to fund incremental turnarounds within the companies that they're looking at. So ARCs will now play an increasingly turnaround-oriented role, as against buying portfolio of assets where they simply liquidated the underlying security. They will now look at turning around enterprises. So one is, of course, they'll have to have the capital. Secondly, they'll have to have the aggregation ability. Thirdly, they'll have to have the credibility and the trust that the banks actually trust them. And finally, they will need to have actual operating resolution professionals who can go around and help turn around those companies. So if this is where the role of an asset reconstruction company will now come about. Earlier, it started off by simply palming off an asset to an ARC so that they can hold it, as against the bank holding it and attracting provisions. So the arbitrage that was there, regulatory arbitrage, is no longer the reason for ARCs to exist. Going forward, it's going to be turnaround capabilities plus ability to put in capital, which will drive an ARC's growth.
Okay, so we have time for just one more question. If you could send your questions in. Okay, we have a question from Sandeep. For Rahul, you mentioned the cost of capitals for ARC are higher than that of banks as one of the challenges. Can you elaborate on this?
Sure. So typically what happens is when an ARC kind of prices any loan, they're expecting the recovery to come over a period of time. So what they do as a kind of a pricing mechanism is they factor in recoveries at various points in time, and they discount it for the rate at which their borrowing costs are. Because ARC being specialized vehicles, and at least earlier, I mean before the FDI thing opened up, there are very few sources from where the ARCs could kind of raise money. There was a leverage option also available for the ARCs, but except for a couple of ARCs, the leverage option was not really looked at. And I think the other point to note is, the popular concept of higher the risk, higher the reward typically gets in any kind of a distressed situation. If I were to just give a flavor of what happens globally in terms of the distressed assets, the funds, I mean the large private equity funds which kind of look at distressed assets have a very high return expectations, because the kind of efforts and the time required to revive a loan is far more higher than actually working with a standard loan. So it goes with the popular concept of saying the higher the risk, higher the reward. I think gets extended to our situation as well, because the capital availability and the sources of capital are extremely scarce for an ARC, because there are very high restrictions in terms of raising funds within the ARC ambit, at least prior to the budget. Before the budget opened up with 100% FDI. So the cost of capital typically for an ARC is in the range of anywhere between 18 to 20%. As against that, you compare that with the banks, which are primarily the public sector banks, which kind of borrow at much cheaper rates. So while an ARC can price their asset at upwards of 20%, when a bank, while selling this asset, discounts the recoveries over a period of time, they tend to use a rate which is representative of their borrowing cost, which is more closer to 10-11%. So straight away we have a difference of about anywhere between 10 to 12% in terms of the pricing. And this can lead to at least a 30-40% pricing gap in terms of the expectations vis-a-vis what an ARC is willing to offer. This has in fact increased specifically after the minimum investment increased from 5 to 15%. And the reason for that is under the 5% regime, the ARC used to kind of make their returns of 20% plus through the management trusteeship fee, which used to be typically anywhere between 1.75 to 2% per annum. So over a period of 3 years, they make about 6%, which kind of covers their principal costs. And anything over and above is primarily taking care of the returns. But when the 5% moved to a 15%, it kind of completely altered the commercials for an ARC. So that's where the pressure started being felt in terms of the pricing. And it led actually to a massive price gap in terms of the expectations.
I'd like to thank everybody for spending time on this webinar, and apologies again for starting a bit late. If you have any queries or any questions, Rahul or me will be glad to answer. Our coordinates are available. Imarticus, if you want to share it with everybody, we'll be glad to. But we're happy to answer any questions you want even later. Thank you.
Yeah, so what we can do is you can always reply back on the mail that you would have received from us, or you can write into elearning@imarticus.com and with any of your questions, and we'll get in touch with the team from EY, and then we'll get back to you with the questions that we would, with the answers to the questions that you would have. Thank you everyone for attending the webinar.